June 5th, 2018. I'm going to be discussing today, saying the Talacha Lema'aseh, the practice among some communities to turn the back to the Hekhal during the Chadodi. So when I was growing up in Brooklyn, I studied in Bet Torah sometimes, in Sha'ar Esion, in Ahava Be'Ahva, in Sitchu, in Megan David of Bensonhurst. I never saw people turning the back to the Hekhal during the Chadodi. Never saw it. Didn't exist. Or at least none of the Bate Knesset that I saw, not in the community at least. Then I came to Eretz Yisrael, and what I saw in Eretz Yisrael was that almost all of the Sephardi Bate Knesset, I don't miss out the Bate Knesset that I saw, in fact I can't think of a single one where they didn't turn the back to the Hekhal during the Chadodi. So this was a bit confusing to me, because I know that in our community we always preserve the old minhagim, and it seems strange that there would be such a strong disconnect between what the Sephardi Bate Knesset are doing in Israel and what they were doing in Brooklyn. I don't know what they're doing today, by the way. I have to say, I don't know what they're doing. I heard that today some of the Bate Knesset, they do turn the back though during the Chadodi, but I don't know because I'm not in Brooklyn, so I'm not going to comment on what's happening in Brooklyn. Rather, I will focus on the practice itself. And just one more introduction. I'm not talking about the practice of, at the end of the Chadodi, bowing a little to the right or the west side, bowing a little to the east side or to the left. I'm not talking about that practice. That's a different minhag. I'm just talking about turning the back to the Hekhal. What do they do in Eretz Yisrael and in the synagogues? They say Mizmor LeDavid. Already from Mizmor LeDavid, their back is to the Hekhal. They're facing whatever direction they're facing. And LeChadodi, back is to the Hekhal. They're facing whatever direction they're facing. And then during Mizmor Shalom Shabbat, they turn around and they say facing the Hekhal. I'm dealing only with that practice. Question. Where does it come from? Next. Very important. If the answer to where does it come from is it's a Kabbalistic custom, are we or are the people performing this practice of turning back to the Hekhal, are they performing in accordance with the Kabbalistic norms? Is it being performed correctly? And third question, if it's not being performed correctly, should it be being performed in a erroneous manner? Should it be performed by people who are non-mikubalim? By people who don't really understand the Kabbalistic practice or the kavanot? Because there's many kavanot with this practice. So I just want to go in reverse. So I'm in Israel, I see all the Bate Knesset, and they're all turning their back to the Hekhal. I wasn't raised that way. It didn't seem right to me. Maybe I'll explain later on why intuitively this something didn't connect. But okay, I go to visit Alav HaShalom, one of the great Sephardi Chachamim of our generation, Rabbi David Shlush. I go to visit him. The Pasuk says, She'al Avicha Ve'agercha Zekenecha Ve'omulach. If you have a question, go to the elders. Why the elders are familiar with the older practices and norms. So I said, you know, let me ask Rabbi David Shlush. And there's something special about Rabbi David Shlush, other than there was a great Chacham, is he was raised in Yerushalayim, in HaKodesh, Kimei Olam Ukshanim Kadmoniyot. He was raised there before the Six-Day War, even before Kuma Medina. If I'm not mistaken, during the days of the Ottoman Empire, he was already in Yerushalayim, in HaKodesh, and he knows all of the practices of the Sephardi Keilot. So I asked Rabbi David Shlush, Chacham, מה היה מנהג של קהילות עדות המזרח בירושלים בעת קבלת שבת? האם נתנו גב להיכל? That was my question. Did the Sephardi Bate Knesset, the עדות מזרח synagogues, was a practice to give the back to the Hekhal and face another direction during the Chadodi? And the answer surprised me. No. There was no practice of turning the back to the Hekhal in the Sephardi Edot Mizrach Kehilot. He brought the Spanyoli Kehilot, he brought the Yerushalmi Kehilot, he brought the Moroccan Kehilot, He brought the Iraqi Kehilot and probably brought others. And he said, none of these Kehilot turned the back to the Hekhal during the Chabadi. So I said, so where did it start? He says, he recalls that outside the city of Yerushalayim, outside the old city, there were some new Hasidic Kehilot, Ashkenazim, and that their custom that they brought from there, wherever countries they came from, their custom was, in fact, to turn the back to the Hekhal. But among the Sephardi Kehilot, this never happened. Never happened. I said, you know what? Let me open up one of my favorite books. Keter Shem Tov of Rabbi Yom Tov Gagin. Keter Shem Tov of Rabbi Yom Tov Gagin. Rabbi Yom Tov Gagin himself was the grandson of Rabbi Chaim Gagin, who was the first Hacham Bashi in Eretz Yisrael. More importantly, he was a great-great-grandson, a descendant of Rabbi Shalom Shalabi, who was a Mekubal. So Rabbi Yom Tov Gagin comes from this background. He knows the Halakha, he knows the Kabbalah, or he knows the Kabbalistic practices. He knows actually all of the practices, and he wrote this book called Keter Shem Tov. And in this book, he brings all the minhagim regarding the tefillot. And I remember Nishmato Eden, one of my favorite people, Dennis Duay. I used to love him because his approach to halacha was so, you know, emet, Shulchan Aruch. I used to also look at Kaf HaChaim, used to look at the Chidah. He used to look at Keter Shem Tov. And I remember him and my father, always whenever they would have a discussion regarding a particular practice for the tefillah, they would open up Dennis, Alav HaShalom, and my father, Shiva Adel HaChaim Arukim, they would open up the Keter Shem Tov, and they would see what the Keter Shem Tov says. So give me a moment to find the portion on Kabbalat Shabbat, because what he writes here about Kabbalat Shabbat was surprising to me. And it was surprising because he doesn't bring the custom of turning the back to the Hekhal. He doesn't bring it. He brings the, let me read to you what he says. This is the first volume of Keter Shem Tov, Daf Kof Pe Bet. Listen what he writes. He's writing about Kabbalat Shabbat. Minhag London ve Amsterdam, the custom of London and Amsterdam. I'm just going to translate it into English. Enam omdim b'sha'at Kabbalat Shabbat. They don't even stand during Kabbalat Shabbat. Uchshemagi ha-shaleach sigul leboi b'shalom, at the end of the Chadadi, they would stand up and then they would sit. That was it. Doesn't in the footnotes, the for those of you not familiar with Keter Shem Tov, there's a main text where he brings the general minhag. But then in the footnote, he brings all the various, you know, different types of minhagim, different permutations of minhagim. So I looked at the footnotes, and he brings something here. He brings them again, Avraham, the Masekim, the Shulchan Aruch, and Siman, Resh, Samich, Bed. It says, HaKabbalat Shabbat, Tov Lalechet Pasadot, Ulkabel Et HaShabbat. It was a custom to go to the fields and do Kabbalat Shabbat in the fields. Okay. Then he brings a custom of a Sephardi Bet Knesset in Paris. He lived in the late 19th century, early 20th century. So he says that in the Sephardi Bet Knesset in Paris, they used to leave the Knesset before Shabbat. And as the sun was setting, they would do Kabbalat Shabbat by entering the Knesset together, the Chazan saying Shinim for Shabbat. And this is the way they did Kabbalat Shabbat. Then he brings the Minhag Ha'ari, the custom of the Ari. And listen what he writes. Hayam mekabel Shabbat, pam basadeh, upam bebeto. He had two Kabbalat Shabbat. This is the minhag of the Mekubalim. One Kabbalat Shabbat was done in the field, outside, and the other Kabbalat Shabbat was done in his house, where we do some hakafot around the Shulchan Shabbat. There was a variation of this minhag where they would do the Kabbalat Shabbat in the field, and then they would go to the Knis and do hakafot around the Teva. That's the old Kabbalistic minhag. Now, Rabbi Yom Tov Gagin does not bring, and he brings all of the minhagim, but he doesn't bring the minhag of turning the back to the Hekhal. He doesn't bring that minhag. He does bring the minhag of bowing to the let me read to you what he says so there's no mistake. So you all, this is Daf Kof Pedalet. Tam le minhagenu lehafoch panenu. Why do we incline our faces at the end of lechadadi, right? Boy, boy kala, boy kala. We go right, we go left, or west and east. As I said at the beginning of this video, of the shi'ur, that's a different subject. I'm not dealing with that now. I want to read before you, though, a description of the old Kabbalistic minhag. And for this, I have to thank my friend, Chacham Yosef Moseri, Joey Moseri, who was gracious enough to send me via WhatsApp some of the mikorot, and in that way he saved me some of the time. And listen to what's written in a book called Hemdat Abraham, which is a series of she'elot u'tshuvot in different subject matters of Rabbi Abraham Hadayan, and it says as follows: Katuv beSefer Sha'ar HaKavanot. Okay, Sha'ar HaKavanot brings the minhagim of the Ari. Okay, this is a Kabbalistic book. Okay. Kisur Seder Kabbalat Shabbat Hu Sheteseh LaSadeh. When they used to do Kabbalat Shabbat, they used to go to the fields. It's very important, by the way. They used to go to the fields. V'tomar bo v'neseh l'krat Shabbat Malketa l'chakat l'kohin k'dishim v'ta'amod me'omed v'makom achad basadeh. And you choose a place in the field. If it's a high place where you have a nice a view, even better. Obviously it has to be a clean place, and so on and so forth. And you face the west. Why do you face the west? We'll elaborate upon this a little more, but here he says, Sheshamak Hama Shoka, that's where the sun sets. Ube'et Shekiata Mamash, Tesgor Einecha, Vetasim Adecha Semalit, etc. Vetachim Mizmol LeDavid. The moment the sun sets, and I'm going to repeat the sentence again, this is an important sentence. Ube'et Shekiata Mamash, at the exact moment of sunset, because you're facing the west, so you see where it's setting. At that moment, you start Kabbalat Shabbat. Mizmor le David, Abu Adonai ben Elim, Abu Adonai Kavod va'os. Right, you're starting the Kabbalat Shabbat. Right, ve'achakach yomar boi kala lechad, and so on. Mizmor shelim haShabbat, and then they would leave the fields and either go back to their house where they would have a second Kabbalat Shabbat ceremony, or go to the Bet Knesset. But different variations. Important point. This Kabbalistic minhag, was it practiced by everyone? No. It was practiced by the Mekubalim. And why was it practiced by the Mekubalim? Because there are certain nuances here that would naturally be done properly by the Mekubalim, but not everybody is a Mekubal. Not everyone can follow these nuances, and we'll soon see what these are. More importantly, the Mikubalim who did this, where did they do this? They did this in the field. They didn't turn their back to the Hekhal. They were facing the setting sun, waiting for the moment that the sun sets, and at that instant, they would say, Shabbat is now, they saw Mizmor le David. Let's continue. Gam Sidur Rabbeinu HaRashash. We mentioned the great-great-great-grandfather of Rabbeinu Yotov Gagim, who was a great Kabbalist. In his Sidur it says, Sheyaseh LaSadeh, go out to the field, V'yavzir Panav L'sad Ma'arav, he would face the west, U'v'shki'at HaChama Yisgor Einav V'yasim Yadav Al-Hazeh. And then at the moment the sun would set, he would do Kabbalat Shabbat, but he would see the sun setting, and at that instant he would do the Kabbalat Shabbat. Another Kabbalistic book. Ure od be'orech be'peri o'es payim. Shav HaShabbat. Shemashma, this peri es payim, shemashma she'asedu Kabbalat Shabbat basadeh, ve'achakach ha'kafat shulchan ba'bay. They would do again two Kabbalat Shabbat, one Kabbalat Shabbat in the field. Second Kabbalat Shabbat, they would go back to the house and do a kafot around the Shulchan Shabbat, and then they would go to the Knis. Let's continue. Benish Chai. The Benish Chai on Perashat Legira, the second year, he brings this Kabbalistic custom. And listen to what the Benish Chai writes. Let me see if I can find it. סדר קבלת שבת כפי דברי רבנו האריזה הוא כך הנה בתחילת הכל אם אפשר לעשות קבלת שבת בשדה מה טוב ומה נעים if you can follow בן איש חי in many of his הלכות tended towards the Kabbalistic customs so he says if you want to follow the Kabbalistic custom this would be the proper thing to do and go to the field מה טוב ומה נעים, והוא מצווה מן המובחר, ואם אי אפשר לעשותו בשדה, טוב לשאת בקבלת שבת לחסר במקום פנוי ומגולה. But sometimes people can't make it to the field, so I said, if you can't make it to the field, then go outside to a place where there's a sky above your head. And do the קבלת שבת there, facing the west, and waiting for sunset, and at the moment of sunset, start the קבלת שבת. Again, the Ben Ish Chai does not say to turn the back to the Hekhal during Kabbalat Shabbat because he's talking about Kabbalat Shabbat outside. The custom in Beth El, and I'm pretty sure it's brought in this Hamdat Abraham, the custom in Beth El was they would be in the Knis, they would leave the Knis for Kabbalat Shabbat and go to the Haser, which was open to the sky, and do the Kabbalistic custom brought by Ha'ari, facing the west. Again, they were not turning their back to the Hekhal. So, you can look at all of the old sources, all of the old Mekubalim. There was no custom to sit inside or to stand in the Knis and switch your orientation from the Hekhal with the back to the Hekhal and then turn with the back to the Hekhal. Doesn't exist. Let's continue though. Yes. Here, another source for this custom, the Bir Chaim Sotehon, the Erez Chaim, great Chal from Chala, B'Shem Arav Shemen Sasson, Again, this was the Kabbalistic custom. This was not the custom for everyone. The Mekubalim, they have a certain understanding. They have a certain learning. Right? So, if you're a real Mekubal and you studied Moharachu, you studied Es Hayim, you understand the certain things. So, go with other Mekubalim and follow the practice of the Mekubalim, that this was not a universal custom. So again, ki minahag ha-mekubalim ve'ir ha-kodesh Yerushalayim le-hakif ha-teva ve-bet ha-keneset. They would make a hakafa in the knis, hakafa, right, go around. Right. Ki lefi dibrei ha-ari, zarich lekabel Shabbat she-tei pe'amim achat basadeh ve-achat basadeh. Because the Kabbalistic custom was to first accept Shabbat outside and then come back and do hakafot in the house around the Shulchan Shabbat. But, ulfi ze nahagu bebet el, lasot hakafa bebet ha-keneset bimkom babayit. But what happened in Yeshiva Bet El, Yeshiva Mekubalim, they said, instead of going home and doing the second part of Kabbalat Shabbat in the house, let's do it in the Knis. So just to summarize. And let me read one more sentence in this Teshuvah Rabbi Chaim Sotehon. באולם פשוט שהם מקבלים שבת גם בשדה או בחסר. They would do קבלת שבת either in the field or outside in the חסר, the courtyard, where you can see the sky. Not in the Knis. כל אחד לעצמו כשהוא עומד בפניו למערב and outside in the field or in the חסר. That's when they would turn west. They wouldn't give the back to the Hekhal, to the Aron HaKodesh. Doesn't exist. That practice is new, at least for Edot HaMizrach, at least for the Mekubalim we seem to want to emulate, even if we're not doing it correctly, because I'm going to explain soon why the way we're doing it is not according to the Mekubalim. So the Kabbalistic custom is a very clear custom. It started by going to the field and then coming home and doing hakafot in the house. But then it turned in Yeshivat Betel, where they would go to the field, again, face west in the field, come to the Knesset, do hakafah around the teva in the Bet Knesset. That was it. That was it. Let me read you a beautiful description, if I can find it. I believe it would be on Gagim also brings the custom of doing the hakafot in the Knesset. Right. Ah, yes, 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 yes. Listen, it's a beautiful, the way he describes it, it's beautiful. Minhag ha'ari haya mekabel Shabbat pa'am basadeh u'pa'am bebeto. This is page Kof Pebet. So the custom of the Ari, as we said, do two kabbalot Shabbat, one in the field, one in his house. U'bebeto haya makif et ha'shulchan ve'omer mizmol shi le'yom ha'shabbat im ha'piyut echad odi. And he would repeat, he would say in the house, he would do ha'kafa around the shulchan Shabbat and say le'chad odi mizmol shi le'yom ha'shabbat. Right. He brings the reason. I'm not reading the reason now because it's not germane to our point, right? And then he says, "Uche'ayin min hagze shorev be'kar kadosh bet el Yerushalayim." In the Knesset Bet El in Jerusalem, the Mekubalim, they have a permutation of this minhag. In this Knesset, mitpalelim al pi kavanot ha'ari. By the way, anybody knows somebody who prays al pi kavanot ha'ari? Anybody know somebody who prays al pi kavanot ha'ari? You ever see the Sidurim? Did anybody see the Sidurim, which contains the Kavanot of Ha'ari? You know what these Kavanot are? I saw it, I was in the Yeshiva of Rabbi Mordechai Atir, Shiva de la Chaim Arukim. I used to study with his father, Rabbi Leo Atir. So this is the Yeshiva of the Kubalim. You ever see the Sidurim? You ever see what the Kavanot they have? You understand the knowledge and the learning that goes behind all these Kavanot? So the people who used to do this custom of doing two Kavanot Shabbat, one in the field facing west, the other doing the Kafot and the Knis, they had certain kavanot. It wasn't just, you know, simple people. Bechulam lebushim lebanim. They would all wear white clothing. Umeotafim betalitotehim. And they would have the talitot on, like we do on Kippur at night. Only they would do it every Kabbalat Shabbat. Vedomim mamash lemalachei hasharet. And they look like malachim. That's why he describes this Kabbalat Shabbat of the Mekubalim. Let's continue. So, now that we understand where this minhag comes from, I want to read to you this is from Kemdat Abraham, Daf Kof Kaf, it's Siman Yotet, and he reaches the following conclusion. You want to follow the Mekubalim? Okay? How do you do that? If you want to follow the Ari, then do it correctly. Okay, I want to give you an example. Let's say comes an Am Ha'aretz, he doesn't know what tefillin is. I mean, you know, he heard something about tefillin, and what does he do? He takes shelo neda, he takes a red leather or gold-colored leather, and he puts, you know, one of perashiyot, puts perashat keriyat shema, and he puts it on himself. Would anybody consider this to be praiseworthy? Or would we criticize a person and say, what are you doing? He says, no, I want to follow the Torah of Moshe Rabbeinu. I want to follow the Shulchan Aruch. I want to follow Harambam to put on tefillin. He says, okay, but this isn't tefillin. You have on, it's one perasha, you only put one perasha in it, you have a red-colored leather or gold-colored leather. He says, yeah, but I like the color gold. This is not the way we perform the mitzvot. The mitzvot is not a free-for-all. It's not isha yashar ve'enav yaseh. Okay. We have here a Kabbalistic custom that was made by great Mekubalim, real Mekubalim. And if you want to follow the Kabbalistic custom, you should try to be a Mekubal, because the Mishnah says, en an ha'ares hasid. If you're not an ha'ares, you're not going to be a hasid, right? So if you know nothing about Kabbalah, and nothing about the Kabbalot, and you never studied a line of Moharahu, so I don't know if you necessarily want to hold yourself out to be a Mekubal. So let's read what he says in Kandat Abraham. He says, you should do two Kabbalot Shabbat. right? V'lecha tefillah yesh la'akmid la'aseh la'chus, and you have to do the Kabbalah Shabbat outside, like the Ari. V'yesh la'akmid lomar bo'o v'neseh l'kat Shabbat. When you leave your house to go to the field, there was pesukim that they would say. You have to say those pesukim. V'zeh bilvad kol ha'kavanot ha'nizkarot v'shar ha'kavanot. Now, in addition, when they used to say these pesukim, they had all these special kavanot that they would have while they're saying the pesukim, while they're doing Kabbalah Shabbat. I don't know anybody who knows these kavanot, except again the yeshiva of the Bimud Lechai Atiyah, where I saw mekubalim. There they study Es Hayim, mekubalim, they know the kavanot. But the simple hamam, you know, people who have trouble reading, sometimes they have trouble reading pesukim. They don't know the kavanot. Mechila. I feel bad saying it, but not everybody knows the kavanot of the great mekubalim. Not everybody knows this kavanot. So if you don't know this kavanot, what are you doing? So you're going out to the field. That's assuming that you're in the fields. Ubishe'ar ha'sefarim ha'kedoshim. Ve'ech shelo yeh, me'atim bilvad, mekayemim ve'no'agim k'divrei ha'ari, k'chtavam ech l'shonam. Very few are the people who know how to actually perform what the Ari said to perform. Two kavanot Shabbat, face the west in the field. Most importantly, when did they do it? They would do it at the moment of sunset. At the moment of sunset. You know, many of the Batei Knesset here in Eretz Yisrael, they start with a Lechu Nera Nera. Nice custom, that takes about 10 minutes. Sometimes they also have Shir HaShirim, in the winter they have Shir HaShirim, that takes another 10, 15 minutes. So 30 minutes, till you even get to Mizmor LeDavid, it's usually at least 30 minutes after sunset. What are you turning to the west for? The whole practice of turning to the west was at the moment of sunset to start Mizmor LeDavid, and you see how the sun sets, so you start Mizmor LeDavid. But if it's after sunset, the whole Minhag Mekubalim was at the moment that the Kedusha of Shabbat descends upon you. You see the sun setting. At that moment you say Mizmor LeDavid. With the Kavanot. And then you continue. You continue with the practice. You go home, you do the Hakafot, you go to the Beit Knesset, you do the Hakafot. What is this? Just turning to the west. And people don't know what they're doing. They're turning the back to the Aron HaKodesh. So he says, V'rol ha'am she'osim divrei ha'ari, osim l'shalish raviyah. They do one-third of that, what the Ari said. They do one-fourth of that, what the Ari said. A person puts on tefillin, he has one parashiyah in the tefillin. That's isur de'oraita. It's asur to do that. Lo tosif lo tigla, it's korea. So what are you doing in Kabbalistic? People do the Kabbalistic custom. You need to understand what they're doing. They don't know how to do the kavanot. They're not precise to start it exactly at the moment of sunset, etc., etc., etc. And therefore, what are we doing? We're pretending. We're pretending to be Kabbalistic. We're pretending to be Hasidim Gedolim. We're pretending. And who are we pretending to? Okay. Let's continue, because I still have quite a lot to say, and I know this class is a bit longer than I like to go on, but we have some important things to say. I want to read to you one of the greatest mikubalim ever, Rabbi Yaakov Al-Ghazi. Rabbi Yisrael Yaakov Al-Ghazi, in his book, Shalmei Sibur. Now, what do I love about? Why do I consider to be one of the greatest hachamim? One of the greatest hacharonim? Because he got two crowns that nobody had. These two crowns: number one, he was the chief rabbi. That's number one. Number two, he also was Rosh Yeshivat HaMekubalim in Bet El, meaning the greatest authority in halakha in his generation was Rabbi Yaakov Al-Ghazi. And the greatest mikubal of his generation was Rabbi Yaakov Al-Ghazi. The combination of these two crowns in one person, I'm not aware of any other chacham that reached this madrigal. And he writes about, should a person perform the tefillah in accordance with the ways of the Ari? Now, mind you, we're talking about Rosh Yeshivat Bet El. So if anything, he's prejudiced to performing Kabbalistic customs. And listen what he writes. This is in Amud Yod Zayin, He says, by the way, the chapter before he speaks about Yohara. How people like to act like they're big Hasidim, they do all these Humrot. And he says, in most of the cases where people do Humrot in public, it's Yohara. It's actually an Avon. What are you saying? That the rest of the Kahal is no good and that you're above the rest of the Kahal? You're doing something that nobody does. Yohara, but okay. We're not talking now about Yohara, we're talking about people who want to show that they're Mikubalim. Let me read you what he writes. Sarich liyot kol adam sanua bechol haminagim asher itnaheg al pi kabalat ish ha'elohim ha'ari. Any person who wants to follow the chumrot of the Ari, and here he's talking about a legitimate Tamid Chacham that studied, that understands, that knows, that's worthy, because not everybody is worthy. This person has to be careful. שלא לפרסם עצמו בפני הנוהגים להקל על פי התלמוד ועל פי הפוסקים השם לפי המנחאים. He cannot do his humrot or his Kabbalistic practices in the presence of other people. He has to be tsanua. He has to hide it. Right? The Pasuk says, ועשני הלכת עם השם הלכה. You have something special that you're doing. Be tsanua about it. Don't show it off. Right, וכמו שכתב בתשובת הגאון הרעם, כל דבר שלא הוזכר, לא בתלמוד בבלי, ולא בתלמוד ירושלמי, ולא דיברו בהם הפוסקים אשר מפיהם אנו חיים. He says, anything that's not brought in the Gemara, not in תלמוד בבלי, not in תלמוד ירושלמי, not brought in the poskim, the Shulchan Aruch, the Rif, the Rosh, not brought. אף על פי שבעלי הקבלה דיברו בו, even though it appears in the Kabbalistic books, אין אנו יכולים להכריע בו למי שאינו נוהג כדברי הקבלה. It is improper to impose Kabbalistic customs upon the people. You want to do it? Do it quietly. בצנעה. You want to go to the field and do Kabbalat Shabbat? You feel that you understand the Moharacho? You feel you understand Sha'ar HaKavanot? Okay, go. Do it. Go to the fields. Do it that way. Go back home. Do a Kafot at home. Come to the Knis. But in the Knis, we follow the Shulchan Aruch, the Mishneh Torah, the Rif, the Rosh, the Ritva, the Rishva. We don't impose, we don't say, oh, but Shara Kabanot says this. This is not, these are not the Kubalim. Right. One of the things that bothers me about turning the back to the Hekhal is, other than the fact that it's taking a Kabbalistic minhag, which has many nuances, as tefillin has many nuances, but if you don't follow the nuances of tefillin, instead of making a mitzvah, you're actually doing an avon. So, you're taking this very sophisticated Kabbalistic practice done by great mekubalim, and you're doing it in an erroneous fashion. I think turning the back to the Hekhal is something that we need to think about. There is a halakha that discusses whether one may turn the back to the Sefer Torah. It's a known halakha, I'm not making any hiddushim here. There's some commentary, there's some discussion whether the isur of turning the back to a Sefer Torah, it's not allowed to turn the back to the Sefer Torah, is that referring to a case where the Sefer Torah is under 10 tefachim? Right? But if it's above 10 tefachim, it's allowed. There's some discussion. I don't want to get into those discussions because I want to deal with something more fundamental. So we have the Aron HaKodesh. So can the Kohanim turn their back to the Aron HaKodesh? So there's discussion. Rambam in Shelot HaTshuvot Pe'er HaDor, the Siman Ayin Chet, he brings the thing of the Kohanim turning the back. He says, okay, the Kohanim turn back because it's Birkat Kohanim. It's Birkat Kohanim. Can a Chacham giving a derasha, he turns his back to the Aron HaKodesh. He's giving a derasha to the Am. And so also when the Chachamim sit, oftentimes their back is to the Hekhal, they say, it's Kavod HaSibur, it's Allah. In general, can a person turn the back to the Hekhal? Not during Tefillah. The Hekhal contains the Sefer Torah. The Sefer Torah we have in the Hekhal represents the words of Hashem spoken to Moshe Rabbeinu. There is no greater Kedusha than the Kedusha of a Sefer Torah. The Shekhinah is in the Hekhal, is in the Aron HaKodesh, because of the Sifrei Torah that are there. If you're facing the Aron HaKodesh, and then you turn your back to the Aron HaKodesh, what is that saying? What does that even mean? I don't know. But it looks a little odd to me. I'll tell you something. And at the time, many people were surprised that I was confused. I once went to the Kotel, Kabalat Shabbat in the Kotel. So, you know, everybody's dancing. It's dancing, they're doing the Hora and clapping hands and this and... Okay, so it's haram. It's haram to dance on Shabbat. It's haram to clap hands on Shabbat. Fine. So I said, this is what they're doing. I'm not going to argue. They have the, this is what they do. Okay. Then came Kabbalat Shabbat. They're all facing the Kotel. They all turned the back to the Kotel. And they're facing the west. Now, we believe Shekhinah lo zaza mikotel ma'aravi. We believe that the Shekhinah is still there. If the Shekhinah is still there, what are you turning your back to? Or more importantly, what are you facing? So at this point, you're turning the back to the Shekhinah, to the Kodesh HaKodashim, where the Shekhinah is still there, and you're facing another direction in prayer. I'm not talking about a person leaving the Kotel because that's it, he's finished, now he wants to go back to his hotel, to his house, to have a cup of coffee. I'm talking about a person praying. So when you pray, you face the Shekhinah. Right? The Kavanah means to be mechaven et datecha, to point your mind towards God, towards the Shekhinah. How can you face the Kotel and then turn your back to the Kotel to what exactly? To what? So there's something else? Chas v'shalom? Or what is it? Or the Shekhinah was there and he jumped there? Now, the Mekubalim, they went to the fields. That was a beautiful minhag. They saw the sun setting, and at that moment, they felt the Kedushah of Shabbat descending upon them. And they're facing the Ma'arav. Ah, that's something. We'll discuss that in a moment. So I saw this custom of suddenly turning the back to the Kotel and praying in another direction to something else. No comment. I'm just sharing a personal experience. I'm just sharing the way I perceived it. But to turn the back to the Sefer Torah, to the Echad, in prayer. Again, I'm not talking about turning the back because you want to leave the Knees. I'm talking about turning the back in prayer, back is towards the Hekhal, where the word of Hashem, the words that Hashem spoke to Moshe Rabbeinu, there is nothing holier in this universe. The Torah exists. Tat ka'ad dorot, lifnei b'riyat ha'olam. The Torah exists before the world was created. It is the holiest thing in the creation. That represents where the Shekhinah is. That's Hashem speaking to us at this moment. And you turn your back to what? Is there something else there? If you can't answer that question, then why are you turning your back? Okay. I want to read to you what the Ben Ishchai says. And the Ben Ishchai, let me see if I can find it. The Ben Ish Chai, I'm not the first one to be concerned about turning the back to the Kotel. The Ben Ish Chai writes about this in, he has a perush called Denayahu, and it's a perush on Tikkuni HaZohar. And he discusses the idea of Shekhinah Ma'arav. So let me just give you a little more background, because the Gemara says There's a machloket in the Gemara, and the Gemara reaches a conclusion that the Shekhinah is in the west. Why is the Shekhinah in the west? Because if you look at the Beit HaMikdash, you used to enter the Beit HaMikdash from the east, you used to face the west, and as you go more and more west, you reach a higher level of Kedusha, until you reach the Kodesh HaKodashim, which is at the furthest most west, and that's why it's Kedusha. So the Shekhinah, Bama'ala. The Gemara says so. Mor Abba, Yibalei L'Chayim Arukim, gave a beautiful explanation, and I believe he got this from the Benu Sa'adar Gaon. The Pasuk says, Usva Hashamayim Lecha Mishtachavim. Why does it say that the armies of the heavens are praying towards Hashem? Because if you look, everything, all the stars are going from east to west. Right? All the stars, the moon, from east to west, the sun, from east to west. So it says, Usva Hashamayim Lecha Mishtachavim, the Shekhinah Ma'ara, and all the stars are, so to speak, bowing down towards HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Usva Hashamayim Lecha Mishtachavim. So, the idea of the west is an idea based upon the Gemara. And there's different halachot related to this law of the west. Right? So for example, where you put the bet, from east to west, or from north to south. Another halachot, halacha lemaaseh. Not discussing it now. I want to read to you what the Ben Ish Chai says in his Perush on Tikkuni HaZohar. Terech, he's talking about where the Ma'arav is. Terech harukot ika besad Ma'arav. There's two types of ma'arab. Ki misal mizrach ha'olam kotel ha'ma'arabi shel Beit HaMikdash ad sof ma'arab ha'olam kol zeh ha'ma'arab nikra achor ki hu achor shel kotel ha'ma'arabi Beit HaMikdash. There is the east side of kotel ha'ma'arabi. So if you enter the Beit HaMikdash from the east, and you enter, the Kodesh HaKodashim is on the west, correct? So let's say this is the Kodesh HaKodashim, just so you see it. So you enter the Beit HaMikdash, entrance is from the east, you enter, so the west is easy. Where is the west? It's a Kodesh HaKodashim. Behind the Kodesh HaKodashim, what do you have? You have the Kotel, right? So let's say this is, just to make it a little easier, let's say this is Kodesh HaKodashim, the green. This is the white paper is the Kotel HaMa'aravi. Actually, the Kotel HaMa'aravi was part of the retaining wall of the Har HaBayit. So, says the Ben Ish Chai, look where I am now. I'm on the east. I'm facing west. If you're facing west this way, that's good. You're facing the Kodesh HaKodashim, correct? But let's say you're from this direction. Says the Ben Ish Chai, something very interesting. If you're in this direction, do you know which way west is? It's not a geometrical, astronomical issue. You want astronomy? Go to NASA, figure out where west and east and south and north is. We're talking here about Kabbalah. And says the Ben Ish Chai, if you're now on this side of the Kotel, when we pray to the Kotel, we're praying this way, correct? The way we're praying is the west. Because the Kodesh HaKodashim is here. So west doesn't depend upon what you learned in school in astronomy. It depends upon how the Mikubalim define west. And the Mikubalim, and the Ben Ish Chai says, the west, if you're entering from this side of the Kodesh HaKodashim, the west is now to my left, where I'm looking. If you're on this side, which means now I'm standing where the Kotel is, the west is to my right. Let's continue in the Ben Ish Chai. וכבי הדין, המתפלל אחר כותל המערבי של בית המקדש, לא ישיב פניו נגד מערב העולם. We should read this every single day in the Kotel, and still they stopped turning their back to the Kotel. Turning the back to the Kotel. Turning the back to the Kodesh HaKodashim. Again, וכבי הדין, המתפלל אחר כותל המערבי של בית המקדש. If you're praying in the Kotel, where we pray today, we go to the Kotel. Lo yashiv panav neged ma'arav ha'olam. You do not face what's called west. You do not face the west of the world. That's astronomy. Ela yahafoch panav keneged kotel ha'maravi. You face the kotel. Yan ki oto ha'maarav shel olam shu achar ha'kotel ma'aravi. Nikra ma'arav shel achol. If you're giving your back to the kotel, and now you're facing the west of astronomy, that's called ma'arav shel achol. But we're not interested in Ma'arav Shel Achor. אבל המערה דאיהו פנים, שהוא מצד מזרח העולם, הצד פנים של הכותל המערבי, זה נקרא המערה. במערה facing east, because now you're on the other side of the kotel, right? You face east, that's where the kedusha is. And then he brings an interesting teshuvah of the Radbaz. I'll bring it because it's a beautiful thing. If I could find it. Huh. The Radbaz in teshuvah Chalek Bet Siman Tarmach. Mi she'anasu likanes bin hakotel ha'maravi leben kodesh ha'kodashim. Right, just an interesting question. We said this is the kodesh ha'kodashim, right? This is the kotel. Let's say a person was between. Should he face the Kotel or should he face the Kodesh HaKodeshim when he's praying? It's asur to be here, by the way. You understand, it's asur to be here because it's because today we don't have we're not tevonim. But let's say a person ended up here an asur by accident. They forced him, so he's here and it comes time to pray. Which way does he face? Does he face the Kotel or does he face the Kodesh HaKodeshim? Yitpalel keneged bet Kodesh HaKodeshim. In that case, he faces the Kodesh HaKodashim, because the main Kedusha is the Kodesh HaKodashim, of course, right? It's higher Kedusha than the Kotel, right? So you always face the Kodesh HaKodashim. So, this, you know, I have more that I'd like to say about it, but I think that at this point, we understand a few things. Perhaps we can summarize. We understand that there was a beautiful, deep, profound minhag mekubalim, to do Kabbalat Shabbat basadot. That was a beautiful minhag. And for those real mekubalim who want to go to the sadot and do it in the sadot, they should. But not in the knis. Because the greatest mekubal of his generation, one of the greatest mekubalim ever, Rabbi Yochanan Gazi, says you don't practice the minhagim of the Ali in the Bet Knesset. These are things you do b'seni'ut. Be'et senu'im chokhmah. You do it b'seni'ut. Okay. And by the way, this goes to other things. A lot of people in Knis, they're like, you know, sometimes they want to show extra how they're more religious than the rest of the Kaaba. I'm not sure that Rabbi Yaakov Agazi will agree with that approach. He won't. Next. To turn the back to the Hekhal. A, there is no Kabbalistic custom to turn the back to the Hekhal. Let's get that out of our discussion. It's not a discussion point. Mekubalim never turned their back to the Hekhal during the Tefillah. Okay. They faced the west because, as we said, the Shekhinah is in the west. But to turn the back to the Hekhal as an act of prayer, what does that mean? Morai Berabotai, I don't understand what that means. I don't understand it. And any Mevim. I don't know what you're turning towards. I don't know what you're praying towards. I do know what you're giving your back towards. And finally, in the Kotel, to turn the back to the Kodesh HaKodashim and pray in the other direction? Shekhinah lo zaza mikotel ha'maravi. It's still there. What are you praying towards? What are you doing? You're imitating a Kabbalistic minhag. You know, a person takes a bite of the tefillin, puts in one pasuk, scribbles a pasuk on a piece of paper, puts it, oh look, I'm doing a big mitzvah. You're not doing a mitzvah, you're doing an avera. You're doing an avera. He puts it on the right hand instead of the other, right? And then the tefillin shel, he puts a tefillin here, between the eyes. It says, be'anecha. So, the lesson is, tamim tihiyayim adonai nuecha. You have to have a little more temimut, a little more, you know, follow the simple mekorot. We have Shulchan Aruch, we have Rambam, we have the Poskim who told us what to do. We don't add Kabbalistic minhagim. Not because there's something wrong with the Kabbalistic minhagim, chas v'shalom, because there's something wrong with us. So people who don't know how to do Kabbalistic minhagim, they take these minhagim and look what they do. They turn the back to the Echal, they turn the back to the Kotel, and they meet hasdim, and they think they're doing a big mitzvah. This is what I wanted to say. Again, I'm not talking about going right, going left, at the end of Nechadodi, some people even do a circle. I'm not talking about any of that. I'm talking about standing in place with the back to the Hekhal. I'm talking about that specific custom. I want to to reflect my thoughts, read to you in some of the writings what this is about, and everybody will reach the conclusion that they need to reach.